Welcome back, honey.
Well, thank you. Welcome back to you too.
We kind of got used to being out of the mode of preaching. It was so funny, y'all. I have to tell you this. This is hilarious. We went to we did a minister's retreat that we had to go be a part of, and they asked us to speak.
It was with Ashley and Carly Teredes.
Yeah,
and Joseph Z and Heather Z.
Bear and I were so fired up because we hadn't spoken in a while.
Yeah.
You know, so Van said he felt like he was
constipated.
And it all just came out. So anyway.
So we're
excited to be back.
Yes.
We thoroughly enjoyed Javan's message.
Yes,
oh,
we did.
My gosh.
Very much.
That was just beyond amazing. The 11 part of his 6-part series, the Passover from the cross, from the Exodus to the cross. And I highly recommend, if you have not heard it, go and listen to it. It was absolutely amazing.
Yes.
So, today we're going to be teaching on the heart of a godly father. The heart of a godly father. And again, happy Father's Day to all of you fathers. We honor you today. So, we just want you to know we love you. And appreciate you for everything you do. And you're a blessing. Hallelujah. You know, I want to begin by saying, you know, I've been very blessed with the man that God gave me. And now we've been together. Well, let me just say it. We started dating 42 years ago. And so we've been married 41 years and some. So after we started dating, we got married 8 months later. So we know it was the right one, and we're very, very happy. And women, let me just say this to you. It's very important for you to be supportive of your husbands and your children's father. It's very important because the Bible says that women are either a crown to their husband or rottenness to their bones. Now, that's extreme. That's extreme, but it is so true. You don't ever want to become a nagging woman. And we're not here to preach to the women today, but I'm just telling you, you want to be able to, when it's all said and done, you want to hear from the Lord, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." And you want to hear from your husband, "Thank you for being by my side all these years and supporting me the way you have." So, but I got to tell you what Van did. Van and I have a hard time surprising each other because we know each other so well. Even when we try to do surprise parties, forget it. It just doesn't work for us. We can read each other pretty well. But I have to say this, one day I was really surprised. And it was Father's Day, his very first Father's Day, and he brought me flowers. And I said, "Wait a minute, this is your day. Why are you bringing me flowers?" And he said, "Because I couldn't have been a father without you." And I went, whoa. I mean, you talk about tears. Oh, my gosh. Y'all, that's amazing. But I'm telling you what an amazing, godly man he has been. And I've been so grateful to the Lord. Because you know what? Not only is Javan his son, but now Van has many sons and daughters. And I'm thankful to the Lord for our position to be able to be in the lives of other people. So thank you, sweetheart, for everything you've done.
Thank you,
I feel like,
baby,
we're kind of far apart here, aren't we?
Well,
are we far apart?
Come on over.
Well,
you know where I live. Come on over here.
We usually are like right next to each other. You know what I mean? This is anyway. I'll leave it like this for today. I'll just reach over and get a few tweaks.
All right.
Time. Is that good?
Yeah, that works. Okay. If y'all would, please, I know Ephesians 6:4 is in part of the notes we gave y'all. If you would go ahead and just put that up on the screen, please, right now, out of place, and put it in the King James Version instead of the New King James Version, please. Ephesians 6:4. "And you, fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord." That word nurture is there in the King James. It does not, they're using another word instead of nurture, but that's very important. The nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, As far as my own daddy was concerned, I had a wonderful, amazing daddy. But he did not train me up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. But he did train me up in nurture and admonition, just not in the Lord. And you say, well, that's falling way sharp, short of the mark. Well, in my case, it didn't, because God took care of me. And I know many of you may have had fathers or had people that did not maybe raise you up in the nursing. He was not against the Lord. He, like my mother, had been hurt by the church along the way, and they purposely, you know, stayed away from church, and within religion is what they called it. But my daddy had a law office, and I tell you what, without fail, he had told his secretary, anytime I ever show up there, because the high school, the junior high, was only 6 or 7 blocks from his law office in South Carolina, right across the bridge from Columbia. And she was instructed, if I show up in that room, to interrupt him at any time so he could come out and talk to me. And that was what happened all the time. So whenever I would go over there to his office, and if he had a client in there, he would say, excuse me just a second. When she would contact him, he'd come out and hug me and tell me, just go get me a cup of coffee, and he'd be with me in a few minutes. So he always made time. He trained me up in the nurture and the admonition of being a good father, of being a good daddy. So I learned that from him. And, you know, God has made it up to me over the years, brought me a real godly woman who actually, I got saved actually at University of South Carolina, shooting pool in the student center when I was 18 years old. In fact, I think I was cutting classes that day and went into the student center there and actually went home. I believe I mentioned this before, but this is back a long time ago. This is like 1972. And went with one of these young men that I knew, had met, and that lived on the other side of town. Went over there, spent the night with he and his parents, and he and his mother led me to Jesus that night. So God will order your steps. He will take care of you, is what I'm going to tell you. Even if you didn't have, you say, well, I didn't have but wasn't raised up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. It's just rejoice. God has got you covered. He's going to go before you and make any crooked pathway straight. And I would have never hardly seen myself in church, much less being pastor in a church now for 23 and a half years. But God is good, and God is he's amazing. So we want to lead into all this, but I want you to know, though, it's imperative to recognize the fact of your own earthly daddy and take what he did put into your life. It's positive. Grab a hold of it and use that as a springboard in the kingdom of God. It will serve you well. It's important to cherish that.
Isn't that saying that says, chew up the meat and spit out the bones?
That's exactly right. All right, if you look at John 14, verse 7, please. John 14, 7 through 10 is where the Father is revealed. And verse 7 says, if you had known me, this is Jesus talking, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also, and from now on know him and have seen him. And Philip said to him, after Jesus just said that, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also, and from now on you know him and have seen him. Then Philip said to him, well, Lord, show us the Father, and it's sufficient for us. And basically he's underlying saying that, you know, Philip, what part of what I just said do you not understand? Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. John 10:30 says, I and my Father are one. I and my Father are one. That's what Jesus is saying. Now, I want to say one more thing about that Ephesians 6:4 and about being raised up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. While we were at this conference, Regina was talking about a while ago, it was about 3 weeks ago in Colorado Springs. It was with Teredez Ministries and Joseph Z and his wife, Z Ministries. And the first part of that time, Joseph Z came up to me at the, where Regina and I were sitting, and he said quite a number of things to Regina and I both, but he, one thing, he looked at me and he said, your daddy did the very best that he knew how. We had had no conversation in that place about anything. He had no way of knowing anything, and that really ministered to my heart to hear from the Lord that your daddy did the very best that he knew how. And you know what? A lot of us are in that same boat with our own daddies, and they did the very best that they knew how. So we build on that. We don't look back and have regrets on that. You build going forward because God has a clear path for you. All right. One thing I saw from Barry Bennett, and some of you may have seen it on Facebook here this week, is he put a quote or put something from his heart. He said, "The heart of the Father is revealed in the ministry of the Son." The heart of the Father is revealed in the ministry of the Son. So we know, it's talking about the Father, Jesus, God our Father, and Jesus. The heart, his heart is revealed through the ministry of his Son, Jesus. And we're the recipients of that. It's not just the people who walk the earth with Jesus, but we all are the recipients of that.
You know, let me just interject this real quick because I know my father would be watching. Daddy, happy Father's Day to you. I love you so much. My father began 4 Assembly of God churches throughout his life. He is now retired. But I just want you to know, Daddy, I honor you, and I appreciate the legacy that you have given our family. Amen. You know, let me just say this. You know, we're talking about how much everything Jesus did, he didn't do anything but what he saw the Father do. This is very, very key and very important to some other things that we're going to be talking about. But in John chapter 5, verse 19 and 20, it says, "Then Jesus answered them and said, most assuredly I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does, and he will show him greater works than these that you may marvel." See, so when all of those who saw Jesus, when he became flesh and dwelt among us, everything he did was to be a mirrored image of what his Father did. Everything he did. But so many people confuse the two. They look at Jesus as, oh, he's the man of peace, walking around with a sheep on his shoulder, and he's just loving everybody. But God, man, he is going to get you. No, whatever Jesus did is what he saw the Father do, and the love that he gave, and everything he did came straight from the Father.
Yes.
We had a friend. Do you want to share about that friend?
Yeah, we had a friend who was in business. Actually, his father had a couple businesses, and he was involved in running those things. And his father was very harsh, very talked down to him. And I mean, this friend at that time was, I'm sure, late 30s, right at 40 years old. And he could not grasp a hold of God the Father. God the Father bothered him. Now, he loved Jesus, and he carried a picture of Jesus around in his wallet.
He did.
But he did not want to talk about the Father because he equated the harshness of God the Father, or the God, his natural Father, is with God the Father. And that's one thing he didn't really understand. If you've seen Jesus, you've seen the Father. The Father is, you know, they are all one. But he never did give that revelation, and this was back long before we started our church and stuff. But even back then, we were trying to minister to him. This has been 28 years ago, 30 years ago. And it was so much that we finally just let it rest after a period of time of trying to help him to understand that. But we cannot take our natural fathers and their mistakes or their inadequacies and try to project that as your heavenly Father. Every good and perfect gift comes from above.
Amen.
Above. with no shadow of turning to that. And our Heavenly Father, it's like we said, if you've seen Jesus or if you know Jesus, you know the Father. And we have an amazing, loving Heavenly Father. So that example I just used a while ago about our friend, it was just so sad to us always because, you know, yet he, I mean, certainly you don't ever see a picture. Oh, this is the Father. You see pictures of Jesus and everybody's, a lot of people's walls and different things. But he just never could, as far as we know, at the time he was in our lives, get a grasp that the Father was, and Jesus were the same, and they were both equally loving and equally, powerful. And I just want to encourage you, every one of you, don't let your natural father, love your natural father. And even if your natural father is deceased and no longer on this earth, don't let any type of anger or bitterness or anything or just an attitude Amen. Towards your father. You could literally be walking around dragging your father's dead body around with a shackle on your leg if you're not careful. And they'd be, in other words, haunting you from the grave or being affecting you in your life. And they might have been passed on 5, 10, 15 years ago because you're letting things in your heart keep you in prison. And don't do that. Just, if they were not kind, if they were not in your lives, whatever, forgive them. Forgive them because it just makes you a prisoner. It doesn't do anything to them, and it probably wouldn't have done anything to them when they're alive. But whether they're alive, whether they're passed on, just That's right. forgive them. It's so imperative even for your own freedom and for your own growth in the Lord.
And I think it's important whether they're alive or not alive.
Yes.
Y'all, so many people have father issues
yes.
even after their fathers have gone.
Absolutely.
But I want to tell you right now, it's so important for you to say, Lord, help me see my father the way you do
yes.
or the way you did when
yes.
he was alive. Help me have that image
yes.
of my father. Help me have that so that I can have forgiveness in my heart if there were things that didn't go right. It's so important because I'm telling you, that will really help because the way the Father sees your Father, the way the Lord sees your Father is so different from what your earthly mindset can recall. So you don't want to carry that on forever and ever. I mean, you would not believe in the number of years that Van and I have been pastors, how many marital issues or all kind of issues that have arisen because of father issues in their lives. And so it's very important. Let this be the day that you are completely restored in your heart concerning any issue that you've ever had with your earthly father.
Amen. Amen.
Or father-in-law.
Yes.
All right? I mean, I'm telling you right now, it is very, very important. Lord, help me to see them the way you do. And
yeah.
God is going to see them with the eyes of love. Amen? And that's
Amen.
What he wants you to do. And forgive and forget and let go and bury the past. Put those things behind you and press on. Amen?
Yeah.
This is very, very important because, like I said, the majority of issues that we've had in a lot of the different counseling sessions that we've dealt with has been father issues.
That's
so
right.
It's real important that you ask the Lord about that. You know, in John 17:3, it says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, our Father,
mm-hmm.
that they may know you." What does that mean, know you? To have that intimacy, to be so intimate with the Father, to be so intimate. Adam knew Eve and she could see. When you have that intimacy and that knowing and you know him, then you trust him, don't you? You can't trust someone you don't know. You can't trust someone that you've never spent time with. But it's going to be up to you to spend time with your Father, your Heavenly Father. Take time to enjoy that fellowship with him. That is so important. But it says, it's talking about God the Father because it says, this eternal life that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent.
Yes.
He's the one who sent Jesus Christ. God the Father sent Jesus Christ. Now it's the Trinity, the three in one. But God loved every one of us so much that he gave his only begotten son for you. Would you do that for somebody? I don't know if I would have given up my son for somebody to save their life like that, to let him go through everything that Jesus went through. Because he loved us. He did that for us. That's the kind of God we serve. That's the kind of God that shows love. He gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He knew there had to be a lamb, like Javan had been preaching on the last several weeks. There had to be a sacrificial lamb that was a perfect being. He had to come in the form of man and go through all the persecution and go through all the suffering so that you and I could have life abundantly. Would you do that with your son? I dare say that is a God of genuine love. And that's the way he wants us to see him, right? And that's what we want to talk about today. You've got to spend time with the Father. You've got to spend time to know him and know his love for you, your Heavenly Father. Amen?
Amen. All right, Luke 15:11, if you would please. Luke 15:11. And this is about the parable of the lost son. So much meat in this parable. So much meat. So much meat about the lost son, the parable son, the prodigal son, and the father, and really the other brother. Then he said, a certain man, Jesus said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed into a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, when he came to the end of himself, everybody say, when he came to the end of himself.
When he came to the end of himself.
Do you know how important that is to come to the end of yourself?
Yeah. Amen.
So many people are wayward. And if we're praying for people that are wayward, one of the good prayers to pray is, Lord, thank you that they're coming to the end of themselves, that they'll be ready and ripe for Jesus, or be ready and ripe to return back to Jesus, and to hear things that make sense to them and minister to them. But as long as they can believe they're self-dependent, or they have the world by the tail, it's not going to work. It's just not going to work. So, Lord, bring them to the end of themselves.
Amen.
And I think that's a good prayer right there. People come to the end of themselves where they realize that they're not self-sufficient, they're God-sufficient. And all these things and every good and the perfect gift does come from above. So it said, and he said, I will, where did I leave off here? And no one gave him anything. Verse 17, when he came to the end of himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And here I am perishing with hunger. I'll arise, go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. You know what? The father never says we're no longer worthy to be called his son or daughter. He does not say that. It doesn't matter how many times we fouled up, messed up. It doesn't matter how many times we've ignored him or disobeyed him or whatever else. He does not say, okay, you're this close to not being my daughter or my son anymore. I'm about ready to cut you off. He doesn't say that.
No,
he does not say that. But this is the perception that the younger son had. He said, I've done all this, I've done all that. And he gave him a list of things he's done and he's guilty of. But he says, so I am no longer worthy to be called your son. And I think that's kind of special the way that's said there. He didn't say, I'm no longer worthy to be your son. I'm no longer worthy to even be called your son. Referred to as your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, when he was still a long way off. See, if the father had not been anticipating him coming back and looking for him and yearning for him to come back, this would not be the case. But it says, and when he was a long way off, his father saw him and had compassion. He was a long way off. He didn't come up and ring the doorbell. He didn't have the servant say, "Hey, guess who's outside? It's your younger son." No. When the son was still, younger son was still a long way off. The prodigal son still a long way off. The father saw him. Now, how did he see him? Because he was up on the roof with binoculars looking for him. He was searching for him. He was like, "I've got to see my younger son. I love him. I know he's not the best manager of money, and he's probably gone through and blown all the money, whatever else. I'm not worried about that. I'm focused on my son that has gone off and coming back to see me." So when he was a long way off and the father saw him, he had compassion. And what did the father do? He didn't say, "Okay, that's good. I see him coming now. I don't want him to see me. I'm going to hide behind this as I look at him through binoculars. And then I'm going to let him come up. I'm going to let him come in. I'm going to play it cool. And, you know, I'll teach him something by doing this. When he comes in, I'll just sit there and, oh, okay, so time to tell me what's been going on, how things been happening," and sitting there tapping your foot a little bit there and stuff. And just, you know, just feel, give me the skinny on what's happened while you've been gone. That's not, he forgot all that nonsense. He said, "No, sirree." He put those binoculars down on top of that roof, and he got down and he ran to that son who was a long way off. The father ran. I don't know what age he was, but he ran. He didn't crawl, and he didn't just kind of limp along. He said he ran, and he ran to him, and he fell on his neck, and he kissed him. And the son said to the father, everything that he had rehearsed, he said, "I've sinned against heaven, and in your sight I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to the servants, this is his response. What was his response to him? There was no response to him. He ignored that. He's like, when you said, "I am no longer worthy to be called your son," he did not address it. He just talked to the servants, and he said to the servants, "Bring out the best robe, that robe of righteousness. Put it on him, and put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf, kill it, and let us eat and be merry." Let's have a party. Let's have a party. The prodigal son had just said, I'm not even worthy to be called your son. He could have said, "Yes, you are. Don't talk like that." He ignored him. He called the servants and said, "Prepare. My son's home. Been missing him. I love him," like he never had gone anywhere before. And he said, "We're going to have a party. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is now found." And they began to be merry. Now, is that the heart of a father? Is that the heart of God? That's the heart of God. Now, the older brother, he had a little bit of twist to this. Now, he had some jealousy. And, you know, if I put myself in his shoes and I'm just being honest, I would say in certain amount of things, I can understand the older brother's take on this.
Yes.
In the natural.
That's right.
But we're not living in the natural. We're supposed to be in the spirit. So his older son was in the field and he came and drew near to the house. He heard the music and the dancing, so he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother's come, and because he received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf." So the older brother was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him, because, you know, it's like, oh man, I've been here, I've been faithful, I've been doing this other, and this jerk brother of mine has been out here living like a criminal and stealing and sleeping around and doing everything crazy. He's blown all your money, and he comes back in and you have a party for him and kill the fatted calf for him. So his father went out to him and pleaded with him, and he answered and said to his father, "Lo, these many years I've been serving you. I've never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat to have a party with that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours. Now, you know, you see how that's written down there? Not as soon as my brother comes back. He could have easily said, as soon as my younger brother comes back. He said, as soon as this son of yours comes, shows up. He said, who has devoured your whole livelihood with harlots, you kill the fatted calf for him with this, for this son of yours. And the daddy said, son, or the father, because this is like our heavenly father, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. Now, what did he mean by that? See, this is supposed to typify, this is like a type and shadow of the Father. God's resources, when one of his sons or daughters goes through a thing and goes off and spends all the money, God's resources are not depleted. His inheritance for us is not depleted because
That's
right. of bad
Amen.
Decisions and riotous living and crazy stuff like that. So he says, so son, you always are with me. And all that I have is yours. He didn't say, well, now, he got his part. Half of, he's already taken his part and blown it off, so the other half is yours. He said, all I have
That's right.
is
Amen.
Yours.
All of it.
All I have is yours.
Every bit of it.
Every
Amen.
Bit of it.
Amen.
It was right that we should make merry and be glad for your brother.
For your brother.
Dead.
He called him your
yes,
brother.
Yes, he called him your brother. The older brother did not say my brother, but
That's right.
the father said your brother. He didn't come back and say my son. He said no, your brother was dead and is alive again and was lost and is now found. You know, my take on this, on all that I have is yours, is the Father,
Amen.
Your heavenly Father is saying, you will not be able to ever deplete any of my resources. You will. I own the cattle on 1,000 hills, and the earth is mine and the fullness thereof. You are my son. You are my daughter.
Amen.
If you've gone astray, or if you have a child that's gone astray, when they come back to me, when they come back to their father, come back to their natural father, come back to me, their heavenly father, who they've shunned, then we're going to welcome them back.
Amen.
We go pull out whatever blesses them. In this case, it was a robe of righteousness, which was a Amen. Ring on a finger, which was sandals. It was having a goat for a party. Whatever blesses them. Because I'm about, God is a corporate God. Corporate father, but he's also an individual father. He cares about each and
Amen.
Every one of you, male or female out here. You are strong and heavy on his heart, always. And he always wants to see, just like Javan and Dora were given that testimony, and as Javan has said in the past, that redemption always leaves you better off than what you were. It looks to me like this prodigal son came back and was better off than
yes,
what
he was
when he left.
So in that story, who suffered the most?
Wait, anybody want to know who suffered the most?
The older brother.
No.
The fatted calf. All right, now we're gonna switch gears here just a little bit. Stephanie, if you have that song ready. While she's getting that song ready, let me just say this. We were talking about what the Father did, and while she's doing that, let me just say this. You know, in Hebrews 10, we don't have time to go to all these scriptures, but you can go and read Hebrews 10 for yourself. But in there, the Lord said, your sins and your lawless deeds, he would remember no more.
Yes.
Now, it wasn't because he forgot. No, he chose not to remember.
Yes.
See, that's the way the story was here with the prodigal son. He only chose to remember the good. And so you have to remember that. When you have this sin in your life and you come back to the Lord, let's say you've been wayward and you come back to the Lord, he's not going to remember. He's not going to say, well, you could have come back if you hadn't gone and slept around with everybody in America. And you could have come back if you hadn't taken all these drugs and drunk yourself to pieces. Drank yourself to pieces. Yeah. And, you know, but I want you to get this, y'all. He sees you as though that never happened. That's the love of the Father for you.
To forget. Yes.
He leaves the 99 and he goes to the one.
Yes.
You may be that one at some point in your life. You know what I'm saying? But he wanted the older son to see, hey, everything I have is yours. Everything I have is yours because it's multiplied. Do you know everything that God has through grace, he's given to all of us? Mm-hmm. Every single one of us have everything he has. That is a supernatural provision of God.
Yes.
Now, so we've talked about the heart of our Heavenly Father. Now we're going to switch gears a little bit, okay? And we're going to listen to this song. And I want you to really listen to the words of this song. This is a song that when Javan was a little boy, ministered to us.
8 years old, and we were in Sarasota, Florida.
And it's by Phillips, Craig, and Dean. And I want you to hear the words. Now, the gear we're switching here is now that you understand the love of the Father, we're going to talk about how do you as fathers need to be. Amen? All right, Stephanie.
With all the
Isn't that a beautiful song? And so, isn't it awesome? See, what you have to understand is people are always watching, but more importantly, your children are always watching every move you make. They'll watch every single thing you do. And you've got to have a desire in your heart to be like the Heavenly Father we've already described to you. That's the example that you want to be. You cannot just say, do as I do, and then you go off and do your own thing, or do as I say and not do as I do. Do as I say, but yet you are out there not behaving in a manner that the Lord would be proud of to you, for you to be an example of Him for your children. That goes for both moms and dads. It is so important that they can look at you and see Jesus, or see the Heavenly Father through the way that you act towards them. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, let me read this scripture. That was my next point. In 1 Corinthians 4, 15 and 16, now, Javan read this earlier, but let me read this to you. It says, for though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I have begotten you through the gospel. Therefore, I urge you to imitate me. He's telling you. He has shown you throughout the word His love for you.
Yes.
Even in the old covenant. So many people say, well, God of the old covenant. No, that same God is the God who loved you in the new covenant.
Yes.
He is the same. You can see the love of Jesus through Him in the old covenant and in the new covenant. And the love of the Father in the old covenant. Y'all, there's so many things. We don't have time to go into all of that, a dissertation about that today. But I want you to understand, God has always been loving. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yes.
So that is the example He wants you to be. He said, and therefore I urge you to imitate me. What? And you can't imitate somebody you're not hanging around.
That's right.
You can't imitate somebody that you spent no time with. So we urge you this week, spend time with your Heavenly Father. Take time to get to know Him so that you will be that example to your children, even if your children are adult children now.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? I don't care how old your children get, they will always be your children.
That's right.
Somebody That's right. needed to hear that today. Amen.
Yeah, if you've fallen short in some of those areas, I mean, you can't go back and redo, but you can go forward from where you are. And God wants you to do that. He wants you to move forward and show your adult children, you know, wherever you are in life, and show them the
That's
love
right.
of God, demonstrate the love of God to them. And if you weren't patient 35 years ago, 40 years ago, be patient. Patience is one of the fruits of the Spirit. You can do it. It's inside of you. And just start a new relationship. And watch what God will do in the middle of that, if that's the case for you. So when Javan was little, real little, and when I would cut the grass, he was always, you know, he wanted to be out there. I've tried to protect him by having him, you know, he could look out the window and stuff. I didn't want a rock to fly up and hit him or something like that, or he'd get too close. But he just really, really, I mean, he really wanted to be out there, and he wanted his own little lawnmower. So, and I think y'all can relate to that. So he had his own little push lawnmower that we got him that
so
he
cute.
Wanted so much, and he'd be pushing the same time I was pushing, paralleling me. And same thing about shaving, because I didn't use an electric razor back then. I used a, you know, straight razor with a shaving cream, and he got a little kit with shaving cream and all that, and he was doing the same thing. And it's really flattering when it's like that, but that's the way God created children. God, they're going to be imitating somebody. It might as well be their parents, right? It should be their parents. So if you, even now, like I said, if they're in adults, you know what? There's still some imitating left to go on. Some things where they see a change in you, where you might have been harsh before and you're loving and kind now, not harsh. Many, many things, whatever the case may be, is never too late to do something and to make some amends in that area.
I can remember when he was little and man, I would be in there hugging or something, and he'd come running. And he would get in between our legs and look up at us and pull our legs together, and he wanted to be right in the middle of it.
Yep,
they watch. They watch the kind of love exactly. you show. They watch the kind of affection you have. They want to be like you. And if they, and you know what? Like I said, if you're going to tell them to do something, then don't let them watch you do what you've told them not to.
Right.
Y'all, this is so important. You know, in Proverbs 17, verse 6, it says, children's children are a crown of the old man, and the glory of the children is their father. You know, so that's saying children's children, even your grandchildren, they will be looking up to you. And this goes on from generation to generation to generation, where they're going to be imitating, and they'll look up to you. And when it says here, children's children are the crown of an old man, and the glory of children is their father. Now, you want to make sure you measure up to that glory. Amen. In John 17:22, it says, the glory which you have given me, I give it to them. This is Jesus when he's talking to the Father. All of chapter 17, y'all need to read it this week, because that is when Jesus is talking to the Father before he goes to the cross. And it's the most amazing conversation he's having with his heavenly Father. But he said, and Father, the glory that you've given to me, I have given it to them, that they may be one just as we are one. All of these are very, very important scriptures.
Proverbs 3:11-12 says, my son, do not despise the chastening or the correction of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights. You know how the Lord corrects us? So many people have a skewed mindset and their understanding of how the Lord corrects us. They think he allows sickness and disease, or he allows you to have a catastrophe or something in your life, or something that's harsh. The Lord corrects us with his word.
That's right.
It's the word of God that brings correction. And even the scripture talks about that. It's his word that brings correction. Exodus 32:7, 8, and 9. And the Lord said to Moses, and this is really funny here. I want you to see this. Get what we're saying. And the Lord said to Moses, go get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They've turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and worshiped it and sacrificed to it and said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, and indeed it is a stiff-necked people. Now remember, back up there in 7. And the Lord said to Moses, go get down, for your people whom you brought out. All right.
Now let me tell you what Moses said back to him.
Here's what Moses' response. Go
in
down.
32:11.
That's verse 30, chapter 32:7-9, and look down at verse 11.
Then Moses pleaded with the Lord, his God, and he said, "Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people whom you have brought?" And it's so funny. How many of you have ever had it where your child has done something wrong, and you might say to him, would you go get your child?
Regina, your son
you go get
has
your,
done this.
You go get your son.
Yes.
But then when they do something really good, oh,
that's
I want to show you what
my son
did. Do you know what I'm talking about? You've seen that, where parents do that, and they say, would you go get your child, because they are misbehaving, they are acting up. Well, that's what was going on between the Lord and Moses. You know, when here they were acting up, and he said, and they used the exact same words. He said, go down. He said, for your people whom you brought. And Moses said, no, your people whom you brought. But they were having this discussion.
That's
you know,
right.
They were letting them know, man.
It's like a mom and a daddy. Yeah.
But anyway, moving on. I thought that was pretty funny. We were reading that the other day. All right. In Colossians 3:21
says, fathers, do not provoke your children lest they become discouraged. How do you provoke your children? Something is no matter what you do, it's not quite right. Or they find fault in this. Or they say things. I tell you what, one thing used to irritate me about my daddy, and it's just in somebody else's book, it just might not be a big deal. But I was born in 1954. So by the time, 64, 68, right around that time frame, I'm 16 years old, whatever, 17 years old. And your daddy would say, you need to get a haircut today. Now, you know, everybody's wearing hair over your ears and like that kind of stuff back during that time frame and through the part of the 70s there. And so I would go get a haircut. Mama would take me down there, and he'd come home. He'd say, you didn't get a chance to get a haircut today? And he knew I had a haircut that day. He knew I'd been to get a haircut. But what he's saying was, between the lines, is you didn't get enough cut off. You didn't do that. And that was one of his big lines. Now, he wouldn't laugh about it anyway. He would use that to try to, you know, to try to make me understand I needed to get more cut off. That way, that provoked me. And I never did say, Daddy, that provokes me. But that's just, and you know, everybody's been guilty. I've been guilty of stuff with Javan, and it's just, you know, it happens. But don't consciously provoke your children to anger, to wrath. Don't cause them, just, you know, talk to them straight out, and don't, you know, but don't talk to them harshly. I tell you what, it doesn't, even to this day, I see Daddy sometimes, and I hear them talk real harshly to their children, and the children obey, but I know they obey out of fear, not out of because of love. And then if I go, I think to myself, I know I can go back and find out how this particular daddy's daddy treated them, and it was the same way. And you know, it doesn't have to be that way. Even if your father treated you that way and you grew up under that kind of thing, let the buck stop here. Just change on a dime and say, Father, Heavenly Father, thank you for showing me to respond with love, to still have law and order and to still have discipline, but to do it in love and not do it in anger and do it in trying to make an example or
let
provoke
me
our children.
Add to that, you know, respect, y'all, is earned. It's not forced.
That's right.
If you want your children to respect you,
yes,
you need to give them a reason to respect you.
That's right.
And it's not going to be by being harsh with them. Now, we didn't say don't have punishment. There is ways, and we're not going to get in today we don't have time to get in today a dissertation on how to discipline your children. But you know what? If you go to the Heavenly Father, He'll show you.
Yes.
If you get in there and you know the Lord like you should, He will show you what is correct and to always end in peace and to, you know, I mean, there are ways, and Van and I have taught classes on this, but, you know, you've got to learn. Man, put yourself in their shoes for a moment. And another thing, you know, be a good listener.
That's right.
Be a good listener to your children.
Yeah.
Don't just always, you know, you have all the words to say, and then you tell them, don't say another word. No, how many of you have ever heard, oh, Lord, how many of you have ever heard that? You know, listen to what's in their hearts. Yes, you may have to discipline, and that's understandable because you want to train them up in the ways of
that's
the Lord.
Right.
But there's ways to do it that's not in anger, but out of godly love.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. And I believe that. I believe
that's
that is,
right.
That is so true.
Let's look at Proverbs 20, verse 7. Now, y'all, this is so important because they're looking at more how you act than anything you'll ever say. Mm-hmm. Did you hear what I said? They're looking at more how you act than anything that words will speak. That's why it says, the righteous man walks in his integrity and his children are blessed after him. You have to walk in integrity. If you want your children to respect you, to honor you, as the Bible says, to honor your parents so that you may have long life on this earth, then you need to show them a reason to honor you. You need to show them something that's godly and of integrity. You need to model that life of integrity.
Yes.
And be as Christ-like as you know how to be in any given situation. And when something happens and you know the anger is coming up, man, count to 10 before you say anything. You know, don't just run, grab something to hit them with or whatever. You take some deep breaths and you seek the Lord before right. You go and you discipline and make sure you discipline out of love.
Yes.
You know, the Strong's for the word integrity. Now, I think this is so good. It's completeness, prosperity, simplicity, uprightness, and this one, I love this. Morally innocent. Morally innocent. Are you living a moral life before your children? Are you in there watching adult movies when they're not around? Or you think they're not around? Are you doing things and using cuss words when you get angry? Are you throwing things with a temper tantrum? If you don't want them to have a temper tantrum, are they seeing you have one? Y'all, this is just flat out stuff you need to hear. Because you need to be the example of Jesus Christ, just like that song that we played for you that is so very important. You know, in Colossians 2, 6 through 10, it says, as you therefore have received Jesus Christ the Lord, so walk in him. Don't just say, I've received the Lord, and then go act like you want to. Rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding with thanksgiving, have a heart of thanksgiving. You know, be thankful for what your children do for you. When you give them chores to do, be thankful when they've completed them and compliment them on it. You know, how many of you ever compliment your children? Now, they might always hear when they've done something wrong, but do you tell them how great they are when they do something good? You should be doing that more than the other. And then it goes on to say here, for in him, in the Lord, dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him who is the head of all principality and power. And when you recognize that you're complete in the Lord, and all of your attributes that you come out with and the way you handle your children should be the attributes of Christ. Amen? Hallelujah.
I'm going to say something about integrity also. Integrity, a good definition of integrity is who you are when nobody's watching.
That's the truth.
Who you are when nobody's monitoring or watching, or you think nobody's watching, but it doesn't make any difference. How do you live your life? You know, even if you've got adult children and you're going forward in life, you want them to always see you never living life in the gray area. You know, so many people like to live life in the gray area, and they will tell you sometimes, it's not illegal. But, you know, and kind of do their hand like that. Well, what does that mean? If it's not, it doesn't right. have to be illegal to not be morally right, or to be questionable, or to be on the fine line.
That's
on
right.
the fine
it's either
edge.
Black or white.
It's just, it's so, right. if there's any question, don't do it.
That's right. That's
Even a
good
question
word.
To walk in integrity, then don't do it. Because
right.
if it's not something that you know that would please God, then don't do it. That's what Joseph did when Joseph was in Egypt. He was above reproach.
Yes.
Everything he did above reproach. And it was good in the sight of the Lord. And so we want to live our lives, too, with integrity, with impeccable integrity, and have, like, an excellent spirit like Daniel.
That is so good. Amen.
An excellent spirit like Daniel. And it is absolutely possible to do so, because Daniel did not have the Holy Spirit living in him. We do. So we've got an advantage over Daniel. And we can live that kind of life. It doesn't mean perfectness, but what it does mean is that we have a heart to
yes.
go the extra mile, a heart to do things that are above reproach. And if somebody, you hear somebody later, you know somebody that well and know they're that type of person, somebody say something about them, you go, uh-uh, no sir. I know them, and I can tell you they're not capable. They would never do
That's
something
right.
like that,
Amen.
Because I know them, and I know they are that what their actions are above reproach. And that's what you want it to be for you. And that's what Regina and I want it to be for us. I mean, we've always strived for that.
And avoid the very appearance
of evil.
Evil.
That's what the word
and,
says.
And telling little white lies.
Avoid the very
little
appearance
white lie, y'all.
Of evil. Yes.
I mean, a little white lie
it's,
is a lie.
This is.
It's just a flat
just,
out lie.
Yeah,
so
just a,
these are things
a buzzword
you need to really
for telling
think
a lie.
About.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Proverbs 13:22 says, a good man leaves an inheritance to his
children,
which would be grandchildren, but the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. The wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. Do you know, I'm going to say this, and this is not me saying this, but I feel like I want to mention this. Joseph Z, who is a very accurate prophet, been around for many years and has his own ministry, but one of the things that we heard when we were from him in Colorado is that there is a storm coming. And in that storm, it's going to wreak some havoc. However, the storm will highlight the believers from the unbelievers. In that storm, there's going to be quite a few things happening. that are not good, but the believers will shine during that time.
Amen.
And so it's not for us to be in fear, but it's for us to be continual good stewards and to look ahead, you know, look at the author and the finisher of faith, look at the Lamb all the time, but know we're getting ready to be blessed, highly blessed as believers. And it'll be apparent who the believers aren't and who the believers are. And I'm hoping during that time a lot of unbelievers will notice that and want to become believers during that time.
Amen.
For the great part of the Great Awakening. So, as far as talking about a good man leaving an inheritance for his children, but the wealth of the sinner stored up for the righteous, I wrote this down. In the process of passing on an inheritance to your children, you need to teach your children about godly stewardship.
Amen.
About godly stewardship, about sowing and reaping. That needs to be taught in the beginning. I did not have that taught to me. You know who taught that to me? This woman right here next to me. She taught me that about a year into our marriage. So that was 1981, and I was born in, what, I was, what, 26 years old? And I couldn't wrap my mind around it, but I started wrapping my heart around it. Now, I knew about not blowing through money. I knew how it was to be debt-free because of the way my parents lived, and my grandparents lived that way. They all, both of them were debt-free. But, of course, when I moved to Atlanta, I'd never lived away from home, so I lost my mind and ran up a big credit card bill. Just like the opposite of everything I had modeled for me my entire life until I was 23 years old. And then Regina and I spent several years trying to get whittling all that debt out of there, getting out of debt. Me working hundreds of hours overtime at Delta Airlines on midnights on the ramp and working like these 15-hour shifts to pay off that debt that we ran up. And most of it, I ran up courting her and with money I didn't have. But anyway, and trying to impress her, I guess.
We went to some really nice
restaurants.
We went
to fancy restaurants at $870, $1,000 a month, some fancy restaurants at $1,000 a month. And I would have never done that before I moved to Atlanta. And I'm not blaming Atlanta for it. I'm blaming love and stupidity for it.
No, the restaurants didn't cost $1,000 a month. That's how much he earned.
Yeah, $1,000 a month is what I earned at Delta. Yeah. So how many of you know you can't live in an apartment on West Peach Street and 14th Street and take your girlfriend to fancy restaurants for make it $1,000, $870 to $1,000 a month? You can't do it. So anyway, so when it came time to pay the piper, I started paying the piper. And we did. But we got that debt all whittled down and got completely out of debt and been out of debt now for about 36 years, 37 years. No debt, zero. So what I'm telling you is I had that mindset of being a good steward and learned that. But the whole thing is sowing and reaping and giving. That's even beyond that. And we did the whole time we were getting out of debt. We continually sowed and reaped and gave, which got us out of debt that much quicker.
You know, let me add this before he reads his next scripture. You know, if you don't help your children to understand in this world,
yes,
while we're here, everything is based on sowing and reaping.
Yes, it is.
Whether you're a Christian or not.
Seed time and
everything
harvest
is based on sowing and reaping. You cannot go to an employer and say, okay, I want my $500 check, and you've never worked a day for them. They're going to tell you to get lost. Right? You're going to have to sow work to reap a paycheck. Right? Man, you can't go to a grocery store and grab a bunch of groceries and walk out the door. No, you're going to have to sow some money to reap some groceries. But you've got to teach your children. That's the way it is with the Lord. You don't just come in and think that, you know, just like a farmer. He can't expect to receive this beautiful harvest if he's never planted a seed.
Yep.
So you've got to teach your children. If you're not teaching your children about sowing and reaping and giving in the kingdom of God, because God will bless you to a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over.
Yes.
But you've got to teach your children when they're young. We started teaching Javan when he was a little boy. You've got to sow something in the offering. God wants to bless you.
Yeah.
We've been blessed, and so we're going to bless others, and God's going to bless you back. That's how it works. We taught him sowing and reaping, so by the time Javan was 15 years old, somebody sowed a car into him. Do you know why? Because Javan, he got so much into the sowing and reaping principle that when his grandparents gave him a $250 check for his birthday, he'd give 125 of it to the Lord. I'm like, wow. You know, because it was so much in his heart. Well, look how God has continued to bless them. Y'all, I'm here to tell you, if you're not teaching your children, you need to find out if your children, are you sowing in the kingdom of God? Because you know what? That is key to the best stewardship realm. And if they want to have an inheritance for their grandchildren, then it's going to be by sowing and reaping.
That's right.
Amen?
That's right. Amen. And you don't, sowing and reaping is not where you just sow 1 month and then you sow maybe the next month and you skip 4 months and then you kind of pick back up again. That's not continuous sowing. If you're continually sowing, you will be continually reaping. Amen? That's the way it works. All right, let's see. If you'll look with me, almost through. We're bringing this thing in for landing. Proverbs 3, verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Honor the
Amen.
Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. So your barns will be filled with plenty. And your vats will overflow with new wine. That is a thread that runs throughout the Old Testament, throughout the New Testament, and never. It's a spiritual law and principle that as long as the earth remains, that will not cease, according to the Word of God. And we have lived it, like she said, now for almost 40 years of being married 41 years, but we've lived it for a good 39 and a half, 40 years of doing that. And then we taught our child, Javan, to do that. And Dora's parents have lived that way in Mexico. We never knew them all those years and didn't meet them until we met them in 2003. But Dora grew up that same way. And so Dora it was no adjustment for her when they got married, her sewing. She understood how to sew. And she also understood how to reap. And we just encourage you to do that. If you're not doing that now, jump on board.
Absolutely.
The water's fine. You don't have to make up for the past like I tried to do one time when I first, after a year of being married to Regina, a year and a half, I started giving everything away because I thought I had to make up for everything. But it doesn't work that way. You start right where you are, sowing and reaping, seed time and harvest.
And it'll make a big difference because, and you tell them it's on your first fruits. It's not just on your
right.
income that you get from a
job. Are you leftovers?
Anybody gives you something, man,
right.
sow on it.
First fruit. You
can't teach this to your children mm-hmm. enough. Show a man, be a giver. Don't be about yourself. Be about others. Bless others. Be a sower and a giver. Give to the kingdom of God and watch him bless you back. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and
running over.
Yeah. It happens every time.
Yes, it does.
Just like the car situation for Javan and Dora now. I mean, y'all, I'm telling you, just like the people that sowed. That man told us, this is the first time I've ever given a car away. Do you know he was going to take that car, trade it in on the car he wanted, and then he would have still had payments on the other car because, you know, they never give you much on those trade-ins. Anyway, not what it's really
not
worth.
Not fair market.
I used to sell cars.
Yeah.
I know. But I'm telling you, because he gave it away, God gave him one completely paid for, exactly what he wanted.
Yes.
Better than what he had.
Yes, 2 years
And nobody was out any
two
money.
2 years younger than what he said.
Do you see what I'm saying? So when you teach your children, man, don't be stingy. Be a giver.
Yes.
And you will prosper. The Lord wants you to prosper. And on everything that comes in, sow out. Give, and it will be given back unto you.
And model it for your children.
Model it to them.
Yes.
Now let's read this last scripture, John 17, 24 through 26. Father, I desire that they also, this is back to Jesus in the prayer that he prayed. The prayer that he was praying, and when he was talking to the Father right before he went to the cross, again, I urge all of you, go and read John chapter 17 this week. Father, I desire that they also, he's talking about all of us, whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundations of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you, and these have known that you have sent me. And I have declared to them your name, and I will declare it, that the love which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Stand up with us, if you would. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord loves us so much. The Father loves you so much. And everything that Jesus did, he imitated the Father. It was all from the Father.
Yes.
And you know what? We can look to the Lord, and fathers, you can be just like our Heavenly Father. You really can. He's given you the ability to be and imitate him, or he wouldn't say in there, imitate me. He wouldn't say that if that weren't true. But I'm telling you right now, his love for you, that he gave his son for you, and his example for you, y'all, I'm telling you, he loves you so much. And fathers and mothers, learn from today and utilize this in your children, in your adult children, in your smaller children, and watch the fruit that remains. And then you will see your children's children reap an inheritance,
yes,
that will last a lifetime.
Amen.
To be passed on to their children's children, should Jesus tarry, which I can't imagine that it would be four more generations from now before he comes, because things are crazy. However, but you know what? We're to live as if we have forever. And we're to occupy until
That's
he
right.
comes. That's what
right.
the word says. You
yes.
occupy until he comes.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
But you be prepared as if he's coming in 5 minutes.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
If you've never asked Jesus to come into your heart as your Lord and Savior, you've never been born again. You've never become given up your old sin nature for the nature of God. God wants to do an exchange with you. He wants to give you his nature, the nature of righteousness, in exchange for your sin nature. You must be born again to go to heaven. You must be, in order to inherit eternal life, you must be born again. If you have not done that and you're here in this sanctuary, please be bold and raise your hand, because we want to lead you in a prayer to receive Jesus as your Lord and to receive him as your Savior, if that's you at all. Okay, I don't see any hands here. If you're watching on live stream, we want to give you the same opportunity to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, to be born again. And we're going to pray a prayer here in just a moment. And it's important, it's vital, it's necessary that you believe in your heart the message of the cross, about Jesus coming as a child, being born again, or being born, going to the cross, carrying our sins, going into the grave, and rising from the grave to be with the Father, and know that Jesus is the Son of God. And these things, and it's important that you know this in your heart, but you must confess it with your mouth. And Jesus said, if you do that, the word says, you will be saved. You will be born again. So Regina and I are going to have a prayer here in just a moment. And she's going to repeat with me. And if you're home watching on live stream, we're going to give you the opportunity to be born again right now. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
I believe. That Jesus is your only begotten Son.
That Jesus is your only begotten Son.
He was born into the earth as a child.
He was born into the earth as a child.
He grew up.
He grew up.
And he went to the cross.
And he went to the cross.
To pay the price for my sins.
Paid the price for my sins.
I
have a sinful nature. Because I'm not born again.
But Jesus took care of that sinful nature on the cross. He went into the grave. And he rose from the dead.
And
he's forever at the right hand of the Father. Because Jesus did this. Carried my sins. Took my old sin nature. And gave me the nature of righteousness. Then I can be born again. I believe this to be true. I'm asking you right now, Jesus. To become the Lord and Savior of my life. And I receive you right now. In Jesus' name. I am now born again.
Amen.
Thank you,
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
If you prayed that prayer, you are born again. You are part of the kingdom of God. And please give us a call at 404-697-5215. Let us know about your born-again experience. and so we can love on you and encourage you. Also, there's another thing you can do. I shouldn't say thing, but another beyond salvation. You must be born again, but even beyond your salvation, if you want to walk in the power of God, you need the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues.
Glory to God. Amen.
If you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit and you know you're not and you're here in this sanctuary, as soon as we end this service here shortly, you can come down. Our prayer ministers will be glad to lead you in the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. If you're watching on live stream, give us a call at that same number, 404-697-5215, and we will talk to you about the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues and lead you in it on the telephone.
Hallelujah.
You need the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. That's what sets Christianity apart, is the power of God. Paul talks about the demonstration of the power of God. God wants us demonstrating his power, because those are like a dinner bell calling people in. Jesus had performed miracles.
Find
he had
man.
Signs and wonders
Find
and demonstrated
man.
All these things, but he operated in the power. He was baptized in the Spirit also. We need it. So if Jesus needs it, we need it. Amen? And thank you, Jesus. All right.
All right. We're going to go ahead and say goodbye to live stream. Live stream, thank you so much
thank
for joining us.
Thank you, everyone on live stream, for
we'll
joining us today.
We'll look forward to next week,
look
this same time, 10 o'clock.
Next Sunday, 10 a.m. Seeing you then. Hallelujah.
All right.
Also, let me mention this. If you're a first time...